you were mentioning 2001 Citizen Kane. You forgot to add Drive, but we'll let that slip.
We won't know about Drive for another 30 years.
30 seconds.
Chances are, if you're the kind of person to watch video essays on YouTube, you've seen Drive. If you haven't seen Drive, you may know the entire plotline just from memes. Since its release in 2011, it has become a mainstay in internet movie culture, a film beloved by the internet generation. The film never clues us into the actual year in which the film takes place, but I'm sure we can glean that information from the makes and models of the cars. I'm not a car guy myself, so I wouldn't know. What I do know is that the film feels like a film that is both modern and a relic of the 80s. The stoic protagonist and slower but more assured pacing clashes with the modern and sleek digital cinematography. On top of that, some of the music, in particular College's A Real Hero, sounds like a song that would have released in the early 2010s, but could also have been a song from the 80s. The film exists, or more accurately, feels like it exists, outside of time, which adds to the overall mythical feeling of the movie. Drive is a film that gets right to the point. It's a film of archetypes playing their roles in a version of Los Angeles in which reality is heightened. It's a classic cowboy or samurai story. If you don't know the connection between cowboys and samurai, I have a video that you should definitely check out. Drive feels like a familiar story, but it's more familiar than you think. It's an adaptation of the novel of the same name by James Salas. But for this video, I'm going to focus on Drive's cinematic influences. The first influence that comes to mind is Walter Hill's 1978 thriller, The Driver. Let's see. The film follows a nameless getaway driver in Los Angeles who doesn't like guns and gets involved in a job that's a setup in which everything goes wrong. As events spiral out of control, backs are stabbed, people are killed, and the driver must fight the people he worked for in order to save the people he cares for. Sounds similar, right? But The Driver isn't that original of a film. It was heavily inspired by Jean-Pierre Melville's Le Samurai, which was released in 1967. Le Samurai was a film about a methodical hitman who lived by the Bushido, Jeff Costello, and an equally methodical detective intent on catching him. Which is basically the story of The Driver, except The Driver features car chases and way more action, whereas Le Samurai was more of a film about building up an atmosphere and mood. So if Drive was inspired by The Driver, and The Driver took major influence from Le Samurai, I think it's safe to assume that Drive was also inspired by Le Samurai. Actually, we don't have to assume. The screenwriter himself, Hossein Amini, said Le Samurai was a huge influence on the script of Drive. There are some striking similarities between these films. Each film has a scene in which the protagonist calmly breaks into a car. In Le Samurai, Jeff opens the door and uses a ring of keys. In the driver lockpicks the car before hotwiring it. In Drive, the driver uses a Slim Jim to unlock the car, and then he hotwires it. In all three cases, they maintain calm, stoic expressions. The tools may change, but the characters are all cut from the same cloth. The films also deal heavily with foils. Jeff has a detective. The driver, the Ryan O'Neill one, has a detective, and the Ryan Gosling version of the driver has Bernie Rose. In the case of Le Samurai, Melville highlights how methodical both of them are. They have similar thought processes, yet are on opposite sides of the law. Walter Hill changed up this dynamic in The Driver. The detective and the driver are still worthy opponents, but the driver is careful, cautious, and methodical, while the detective is arrogant, stubborn, and brash, an inversion of what the audience might have expected. But what's interesting is that Drive strays a little away from these two movies in this respect. In the first two films, the dichotomy was between a cop and a criminal. In Drive, the cops almost play no part. Instead, criminals mirror criminals. And the trait that both the driver and Bernie share is the reluctance to do what they do. If the driver is the reluctant hero, then Bernie is the reluctant villain. They're both protecting what they love and their way of life, and they don't take much pleasure in what they do, but they will do anything they need to. Their personalities are morose, with occasional violent outbursts, and you can blame their problems on their partners, Nino for Bernie and Shannon for the driver, who are both screw-ups and push them into the fiasco that unfolds. Nevertheless, we see the driver as the hero, as he is doing everything he can to protect a widow and her child. Bernie is trying to save his own skin from the Italian mafia, which we don't really see as quite as noble, but to defeat Bernie, the driver has to embrace his shadow. And that brings me to another major through line with all of these films. They all involve the criminal organization that hire the protagonist betraying the hero. The mafia in Le Samurai is afraid that the cops will find proof of Jeff's involvement in the crime and trace it back to them. The driver and Glasses and Teeth just plain hate each other, and in Drive, Nino is trying to cover up the fact that he stole $1 million from the East Coast mob. And in all three movies, the heroes are doing it for the girl. Charles. There are some smaller connections that I'll touch on too. In both Le Samurai and Drive, the heroes don their gloves right before committing crimes, so in both cases, their gloves foreshadow the major action. Also, both Jeff and Driver suffer gunshot wounds on their arms. In Drive, this may not hold much meaning except as a callback. And finally, in the scene in which the driver knocks Nino's car over the cliff, he turns on his car lights before gunning it forward, calling back to Ryan O'Neill's technique of ramming into cars and the driver. Here's a fun little reference in Drive. The elevator scene is calling back to the fire extinguisher scene in Gaspar Noé's Irreversible. But if you think I'm going to give up my monetization and show that scene, well, then you're dead wrong. So Drive is a film that borrows from many films that came before it. I can see all your faces now, those sad expressions that are slowly turning into anger as you're screaming, "So Drive isn't the most original movie ever made?" No. It's not, but it is original in its unoriginality. The driver is a stuntman by day and a getaway driver by night. He lives in a sort of fairy tale version of Los Angeles. To quote Ryan Gosling, basically, when I read the script to Drive and trying to figure out who would do something like this, the only way to make sense of this is that this is a guy that's seen too many movies, and he started to confuse his life for a film. He's lost in the mythology of Hollywood, and he's become an amalgamation of all the characters that he admires. So the driver might be a fan of the two other movies, and thus the callbacks to those films might be deliberate by the character. He might envision himself as a modern-day Clint Eastwood or Steve McQueen. As a stuntman, he dons the mask of the hero in the movie. He wears that same mask when he kills Nino, blurring the distinction between reality and film. The film is pastiche, but it feels like it's that way because of the film's hero, not because of the filmmakers. But even as the film draws heavily from these other films, it sets itself apart at the same time with its distinct mood and feeling. Le Samurai is cold, with heavy uses of grays and browns in its color palette. The driver jettisons an overt style for more of a grounded and gritty aesthetic that was more popular in action films in the 1970s. Drive, however, is all style. It's filled with saturated colors, neon lights, sodium vapor streetlights, and heavy doses of orange and teal. It's a beauty to look at, and the person you can thank for this color explosion of a film is the movie's colorblind director, Nicholas Winding Refn. And to think that he was almost not involved in the film. Initially, Neil Marshall was slated to direct with Hugh Jackman starring. That pairing fell through, so producer Mark Platt brought Ryan Gosling on board and had him choose a director. Gosling wanted Refn, but he was not sure that Refn wanted to direct the film. That all changed on one fateful drive.
Can you drive me home?
Yeah. You tired?
Yeah.
I don't think he wants the job.
Ugh. Turn that up. And I can't fight this feeling anymore. I've forgotten what I started fighting for. Don't you get it, Ryan? This is Drive. It's driving around at night and listening to pop music. This is the movie.
So, are you in?
I'm in.
As for the production of the film, it was a low-budget shoot for an action movie. In the opening scene, Refn held the camera in the car. Refn also had as many actors and above-the-line crew members stay at one house in LA while they shot. They would shoot during the day, or night, and then edit back at the house, or drive around LA and listen to pop music. They would also work together on trimming dialogue from the already short 81-page script. The whole reason Bryan Cranston's character, Shannon, is a chatterbox is because he's making up for the driver hardly saying a word. A lot of his dialogue was actually improvised. Overall, it seems like it was a really fun set, and I think it shows in the film. You can tell the actors are having a lot of fun with their roles, and it makes watching the film a much more enjoyable experience. So we talked about what inspired Drive, but what has Drive inspired? Drive released at a time when vaporwave and 80s nostalgia just started to hit the mainstream, with the album Floral Shop by Macintosh Plus releasing in the same year. Drive also went on to inspire the cult hit video game Hotline Miami. Anybody playing the game can see the similarities. A jacketed silent protagonist fighting against members of the mafia against saturated pastel backgrounds. Perhaps it was the perfect movie that debuted at the perfect time, which can begin to explain why it's still a popular film almost 10 years later. But there are others that believe that Drive's influence has been insidious, ruining a generation of men. Countless green tech stories filled the 4chan boards, with anons across the world recounting Drive's influence on their lives. Many of these disparate, socially awkward young men aspired to be just like the driver. Results varied. Today, Turkey Tom joins us to read us some of their stories.
2011. Watched Drive like once. Try to act like the driver. No money for jacket. My lobster sweatshirt will suffice. Wear it backwards so it matches the scorpion on the back. Get invited to a party by some acquaintances. This is my time to shine. Girl stands next to me. She tries to make small talk. So, what do you do for fun? I wait 3 seconds. I drive. Really? You think you can take me home? Panic. I biked here. Alright. Randomly grab a pair of keys in the bowl near the entrance. We're in the car. I turn it on, put it in reverse, accidentally slam on the pedal. We jut forward. Turns out it was drive. We slam into the garage door. Her head slams into the dashboard. She's bleeding in silence. People come pouring out of the house. What the f-? I stay still like Ryan Gosling at the end of the movie. I think Anon and Jenna are dead. Let's call the ambulance. Wait till there is only a couple of people watching for emergency vehicles. Unbuckle myself, run, and hop on my bike and drive away. Real human being. Be me. Watch Drive. Best f***ing film ever. It comes at the right time. I need a change in my life, and I'm going back to college. I want to become more like the driver. Get a new haircut, a jacket, and try to become as calm as possible. FF 1 week. Third day at college. Feeling confident. Standing tall and relaxed. Get in classroom. Stand in the corner. Sing in my head for a while. Female teacher calls me out. Excuse me, why are you in this class? Wait 4 seconds to answer. It's just the right class for me. People giggle for some reason. Keep a resting face. How come? Wait another 4 seconds. I read a lot. Some girls next to me burst out laughing. Not again. .jpg. I try keeping my cool so that they think I don't crumble under pressure. You're in the wrong class. It's marketing analytics. People still laughing. Realize I'm in the wrong building. I'm probably as red as a f***ing tomato by now. Trying my hardest to keep a calm resting face. Yeah. Leave class slowly without a reaction. Feel the tears behind my eyes as I go home in my bike. They're talking about you, boy, but you're still the same.